So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. So as most of you would be knowing that in this series we try to discuss some concepts that are related to finance and economics current affairs which can be really useful for you if you are preparing for any competitive exam, right? So guys, I am a JRF holder in commerce and management and I have done my post graduation from Delhi School of Economics. So I think that's a brief introduction about your mentor. And now we will move ahead to our questions. And before moving ahead to our questions, let me do the customary thing and ask you to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant and you have been on our channel for the first time, don't forget to subscribe to us. It can help you to get access to a lot of good content which can help you with your exams preparation. And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen. It can help you to stay updated regarding every notification that comes up, right? After that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to get back to them as soon as possible, right? So guys, are you ready for question number one for today? Here is your question number one. I hope the screen is perfectly visible to you. So let me read it out. The question says, out of the following options, select the ones which are creating hurdles in the development of mid-sized firms in India. So this question talks about the problems that are being faced by the mid-sized firms in the country. Here are four options given to you and you have to select the correct statements which are actually creating hurdles, right? Here are five options given to you in the green box. Let's move ahead to the solution for this question. And the solution for this question is option C. So option C means statements 1 and 3 are correct. So 1 and 3. So guys, the first statement, it says high cost of compliance which puts unnecessary financial burden on small businesses compared to their larger peers. So basically, the first problem which mid-sized firms are facing is that they have to follow a lot of rules and regulations. See, following rules and regulation is not a bad thing. But when there are too much of them, it creates many problems for the business person, because if they would be always engaged in fulfilling the compliance norms, then when are they going to run their businesses, or when are they going to plan something new for their businesses or innovate something? Right. So it is very important for any country who wants to industrialize that they should keep the burden, the compliance burden, as less possible on their entrepreneurs. Right. Especially on their budding entrepreneurs like mid-sized firms. See, because the larger firms, they have the dedicated teams, they have professionals who are specialized in these fields. They know how to follow the norms, but mid-sized firms, they do not have such privileges. That is why it is it would be better if government let them off the hook so that they can focus more on increasing their efficiencies and innovation, right? So high cost of compliance, the cost of compliance should be as low as possible and it should be as less time consuming as possible. After that, unfriendly attitude of government towards businesses to avoid problems. This question is not correct. This option is not correct because, as we all know, government has been on a spree to boost entrepreneurship in the country. And even the government wants that the businesses should develop as much as can, because see, businesses and industry, they are the backbone of any economy. And in the current times also, there is nothing more than reviving of businesses that we need to revive our economy, right? After that, third statement, which says lack of access to low cost capital. So this is also one of the major point so this is usually not a problem in the case of larger firms, because see, larger firms, information about them is available. If you talk about companies like Reliance or Tata or SP, there is a lot of information about them in the market, right? So that is why whenever the lenders are lending to them, which are usually banks and NBFCs, whenever they are lending to these larger firms, they do not face problem of the of information insufficiency, because they know whether their borrower is credit worthy or not. But in case of these mid-sized or small-sized firms, it is really difficult for them to avail credit, to avail money for expanding their operations, because there is no information about them. Although there are many steps which have been taken in this respect also. Okay, moving ahead to the last statement, which says excess of mid-sized firms which deprives firms of resources that are necessary to grow into larger firms. So this option is definitely incorrect, because there is no excess of mid-sized firms. Rather, we face a lack of mid-sized firms. So basically, there was an article in Livemint about it, that why India is lagging behind in the count of large firms. So why do you think it is easier for a large firm to operate? Obviously, because it can operate, it can avail the benefit of economies of scale. It is cheaper when you produce on a larger scale, right? And there are many other privileges which are associated with being a larger firm, right? So we need to push our smaller and mid-sized firms into the step ahead, which is becoming a large firm, right? So India is facing a dearth of large firms, and the major hurdle is that we are not boosting our mid-sized firms. The hurdles that are faced by them are not removed. That is why they are not growing into larger firms, right? So we need to push mid-sized firms to let them become large, right? I hope all these statements are clear to you. Moving ahead, here you can see the solution. So India over the years has faced the problem of missing middle. Missing middle means mid-sized firms. After that, there are not enough mid-sized firms. It automatically refutes the fourth statement. After that, India has around 600 large firms. So do you see, in such a huge country like India, there are only 600 large firms. So I hope now you will be able to get an idea that how much is the extent of this problem, right? We only have 600 large firms which earn a revenue of more than $500 million per year. So labor productivity of these firms is 11 times higher than the overall productivity of economy. I just told you it is easier for larger firms to produce, operate on a less cost basis. So these firms are also responsible. Why are they important? Because they contribute 40% to our exports and 20% in the employment generation. They provide formal employment to workforce. See, in India, we have a lot of informal employment. That is not bad, but see, having a formal job is all in a formal sector is always better, because there are benefits associated by it. It is regulated by laws, and there are many things, there are many benefits that the workers get, right? So these large firms, they employ the workforce in formal sector. So it is very important for the benefit or welfare of our workers also that we push the firms into becoming large and regulated. So India has fewer large firms related to GDP. Here a ratio is given to you, which is very important. The ratio of large firms to GDP. See, this ratio is very important, and I'll just tell you why. Here a comparison has been done to countries like China, Malaysia, South Korea, Thailand. So it's okay, China is a very big country by size and also by population. But Malaysia, South Korea, Thailand, these are not very big countries. But still, being a larger country than them, we have lesser firms than them, right? So this ratio, it provides you the number of firms or the relationship of firms in relation to a country's GDP. Basically, they are comparing how much firms are there in a country compared to its economic size, right? So we have lower ratios than China, Malaysia, South Korea and Thailand, even from the smaller countries. So we should, that is why this ratio is very important. Moving ahead to the next question for today. Okay, here is your second question for today, which says Dash facility can be thought of as an insurance policy that covers inadequacy of funds when a firm is not able to raise the money from public that it intended to. Okay, this question talks about a term and you have to select the correct out of these five options. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, which is option E. Option E means backstop. Backstop is the facility which means alternative sources of funding to a company whenever it is not able to raise the money from the public that it intended to. See, guys, why are we saying this backstop facility is like insurance? First of all, let's understand what is the meaning of backstop. For example, let us take a company that needs 100 crores for its new project, right? So this company is thinking that, okay, let me issue shares to the public. Each share is going to cost rupees 100 and I'm going to issue 1 crore shares in the market. So the total will be 10 crore, which is going to provide the company with 100 crores, right? But let's say when the IPO of this company, it comes out, only 60 crores is collected. So this is the amount which is collected by the company. So it is lacking the amount by 40 crores, or it is falling short by 40 crores. In this situation, what the company should do? In this situation, there is a facility that is going to provide the company with the rest of the funds that is known as backstop facility, right? I hope now you get the meaning. That is why we are saying it's like an insurance, because if the company is not able to do what it thought of, then this facility comes to rescue, just like an insurance facility. Here you can see. Okay. Backstop can take various forms in different contexts. First facility that comes under backstop is underwriting. So we all know about underwriting. There are specialized investment bankers who are going to buy the shares of a firm in the case they are not bought by public. So underwriters, they provide backstop facility. After that, one more form comes, which is private equity backstop. So guys, that is why I'm telling you, see, underwriting is a part of backstop facility, right? So there should be no confusion between two terms. There are many other forms in which the backstop facility is available. The second comes private equity backstop. So private equity, we have discussed this term in our previous sessions also. So whenever a company is not able to raise the money it wanted to from public, these private equity firms, using debt, they try to buy out the company and provide the company with the funds that it requires. As you can see, finances the purchase of target company. Which is the target company? The one which was not able to raise funds from public, the required funds, using mostly debt, that is leveraged buyout, and contributes the remainder in the form of equity. So this private equity comes to the rescue and buys the stake in the firm which was not bought by public. After that, the third backstop facility which comes is using revolving credit. So what is now this revolving credit? This revolving credit is a facility which is provided by banks to businesses, and this is usually for their operating expenses or day-to-day expenses. Now what happens is the bank, it provides company with a limit. Let's say the bank is providing the company with a limit of 1 crore. So the company, whenever it wants, it can take the funds out of this limit till the limit of 1 crore. So if it wants 50 lakhs, it can take 50 lakhs, right? But not more than 1 crore. So established a maximum amount, that is the limit, and business can access the funds at any time whenever needed. So these are some different forms of backstop facility. Now, why are we talking about backstop facility? It comes in the next slide. Because SEBI is working on a few measures to reform to ensure liquidity in debt mutual funds. So guys, do you remember the fall of a very big company that led to the deterioration of mutual fund sector? Fall of Franklin Templeton.
I hope you remember it. We discussed the case of Franklin Templeton in detail. Now, after this Franklin Templeton debacle, authorities SEBI, it is worried that it might have an impact on mutual funds. That is why let us provide them with some facilities, or let us take some steps which will help them to ensure liquidity, especially in the debt mutual funds, and let them manage redemption pressure. So guys, if you remember, redemption pressure was the main reason behind the fall of Franklin Templeton. Redemption pressure means many investors at one time, they want to take their money out of the investment scheme, right? So the steps include backstop facility, minimum investment in liquid assets. That is, SEBI might tell the mutual funds that you have to invest 10% or 20% into liquid assets. Why liquid assets? These are the assets which can be easily converted into cash, which have a good market. So if there is any problem, they can easily sell these assets and avoid fire sale of assets. I hope you remember what is fire selling. After that, additional transaction costs for redemption in schemes that have illiquid papers. So all those schemes which have some illiquid papers, that means the schemes who have invested into such companies who are not very popular, who do not enjoy a very good market, if investor wants to take the money out of those funds, those schemes, they would have to pay some additional transaction cost. So this is to discourage investors from pulling back their money so that the mutual fund does not face any redemption pressure, right? So guys, since we are talking about mutual funds, I hope you remember what side pocketing is, and if not, you can ask for its link in the video. It was one of the major topic that we talked about when we were talking about Franklin Templeton. In this diagram, you can see total funding requirement, the available funding, and rest can be managed with backstop facilities, right? Moving ahead to the third question for today. And here is your third question, which says, what is one major objective of NSE, IFSC, SGX Connect that is going to set up at Gift City? I hope you remember what is Gift City and IFSC. Now, you have to tell the correct objective out of these five. Moving ahead to the solution, and the solution says correct option is A, which means the objective here is to create a liquidity pool for Nifty products in the Gift City. So let us now move to the solution. It's a very simple question. See, NSE, Indian Stock Exchange, SGX, Singapore Exchange, they are going to collaborate with each other, NSE and SGX, to set up a connect at Gift City in Gujarat so that international financial services can be provided to investors. So guys, whenever we talk about any step that has been taken in Gift City or in an IFSC, the major reason you can assume that the major reason is that we want to develop, the authorities, they want to develop India as an international finance center, providing all those facilities that major centers of the world like Singapore, Dubai, Hong Kong, they provide, right? So on Tuesday, announced the signing of formal agreements, set up a connect at Gift City. Connect is crucial because it could bring Nifty derivatives volume from SGX to the Indian offshore market. So the derivatives that are based on Nifty 50 index, they can be brought from Singapore exchange to Indian offshore market. See, this is an Indian index, and the derivatives which are traded over this index, it would be good if it would be brought to India, because Singapore is going to collaborate with India. This is going to provide investors with a new investment avenue and leading to more circulation of money in the markets. So SGX is going to establish a special purpose vehicle at Gift City to facilitate trading of its clients at NSE, IFSC. Right, a very simple question. Moving ahead, here you can see fourth question for today. And the fourth question says, Dash is a process that delivers an in-depth blueprint of the organizational structure, its technology, people, processes, upstream and downstream customers and their relationships. And the correct option for this question is option D. So option D means the correct option is corporate profiling. So the name in itself tells you corporate, which relates to company. Profiling comes from profile. Basically, preparing a profile for companies. So just as you prepare your profile on social media, you go to Facebook, you add a picture, or you want to see some prospective employers, you go to LinkedIn, you make your account, put your picture there, and tell everything about your educational details to professional experience. Same is the profile word, but it relates to companies. Basically, preparing a profile of the company, that where it has invested, what are the investments, what are assets, what are liabilities, or what are the contingent liabilities that companies can face. So basically everything, every detail about the company comes under company profiling or corporate profiling. And why is it important that we are going to learn in this solution? You can see here, to identify compliant corporate entities. So basically, non-compliant, sorry. So basically, so that government can identify, or the authorities can identify, that which firm is following the norms, or which firm is compliant and which firm is not, right? So if they would have a database of companies, it is going to be easier to classify them into compliant and non-compliant entities. Government is planning to use data analytics and artificial intelligence. So basically they are pushing the use of technology into corporate profiling, behavior analysis, as well as fraud analysis and alerts. So guys, why is this being done? So that if anything wrong is going on in a company, see, a company has investment from a lot of people, right? Many retail investors also buy their shares or debenture or bonds, right? So they have money invested of common people. That is why it becomes the responsibility of authorities to see whether everything is going on perfectly or not. Or if there is a chance, or if there is a probability that some little mistake can one day lead to a scam or a disaster, and it can lead to loss of investors' money, then it is the duty of authorities to prevent such happening, right? That is why fraud analysis and alerts. Various technical capabilities will be used to keep a tab on non-compliant entities. So those which are not following rules, they will be made to follow them. Through the Corporate Affairs Ministry's portal MCA21. So this is a portal which is going to help authorities supervise the firms. It is a portal through which companies submit their various regulatory filings. So you see that companies provide their details on this portal called MCA21. So that is why providing a database to government, which implements Companies Act 2013 and Limited Liability Partnership Act 2008. So it discloses the filing position of the said document. So it tells that which company has filed what document and what is missing in the profile of which company, whether they are holding AGMs properly, or they are taking the interest of shareholders in consideration, and all the other stakeholders too. So whether the company is an active compliant or not. Very simple question. Moving ahead to the last question for today, and here is your fifth question, which says, which scheme was recently recommended by IFSCA to be extended to derivatives trading, margin payments and domestic investors? Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is option B, which means the scheme is liberalized remittance scheme. So if you remember, we have discussed about this scheme in our previous sessions also, and if not, that is perfectly fine. You can either ask for a link in the comment, or we are going to discuss it here in brief also, right? So committee was set up by IFSCA. What is IFSCA? International Finance Services Center Authority, which monitors and supervises IFSCs. On Monday, they submitted its first interim report for the development of international finance retail business. So So IFSC recommended an extension of, so now this authority, it said that we should extend the LRS for derivatives trading, margin payments and for domestic investors. Now what does it mean? First let us learn about what is LRS. See, under this LRS scheme, residents are allowed to invest up to $250,000 a year only in stocks and properties abroad. So if there is a person who wants to invest abroad in properties or stocks in other countries, they have a limit. They can do it up to a limit of this amount. Right? So see, why are normal citizens of a country not allowed to have much big investment? Because it is very risky to invest in other countries. Right? That is why a limit has been provided. So this rule, currently it prohibits Indian residents from investing in derivatives such as futures options and making payments for margins or margin calls on overseas exchanges. So this rule prohibits Indian investors, that doesn't allow Indian investors to deal in derivatives on foreign stock exchanges. So if you are going to deal on foreign stock exchanges, you will have to make some payments, whether it is for margin payments. So I hope you remember what are margin payments, or any other payment related to your investment, right? So earlier Indian citizens, they were not allowed to invest abroad more than in derivatives such as futures and options. But now they are saying that let us allow the scheme to derivative trading also, so that investors get a limit and they can invest up to that limit. That is going to allow development of investors in India, right? And also it is going to integrate India with the rest of the world. So this is expected to offer a range of financial services products to Indian diaspora. So Indian investors, they are also going to get a wide range of products to deal in. Obviously, if a benefit is being provided on a new investment opportunity is being provided, risk comes along with it. So, but a little risk has to be taken by investors. It is not possible to develop your markets, develop your economy, if you're not allowing your investors to take risks. So risk taking is very important, but authorities have to maintain a balance between risk and rewards. They should not let any systemic risk there, which can affect the entire financial system, right? So that is why LRS is being thought to be extended to these trading derivatives trading also, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And before I end the session, I would like to ask you something. So today we were discussing about IPOs and underwriting, right? So guys, recently in Indian market, there have been some IPOs. So I would like you to research on them a little bit. It's good if you know it or if you already know it. So just mention in the comments little bit about the companies which are coming up with IPO and the response they are getting from public. So as we discussed, do they need backstop facility, or they are getting a good response, right? So in this week also, there have been some major IPOs, and also in these past 15 days. Let's see who comments about what company, right? So guys, this is it for today. I'll see you tomorrow with some new set of information. Till then, goodbye, take care of your health, and I'll see you tomorrow.